Welcome to From Newcastle, a podcast featuring the latest developments in health, science, culture, and the creative arts from Newcastle University. In this series, From Newcastle for Engagement, we'll hear about how our teaching and research is shared, enriched, and enhanced through partnerships and collaborations working beyond the university. Discover the different ways in which our work is having a positive impact, improving the economy, health, social well-being, and cultural richness of the places in which we operate. Hi, I'm James, and you're listening to From Newcastle. Today, I'll be talking to Dr. Simon Bowen, who is a Senior Research Associate in the School of Computing at Newcastle University. And alongside him is Hugh Lewis, Customer Services Director at Nexus. Nexus operate the Tyne and Wear Metro, one of the UK's busiest light railway systems, carrying 40 million passengers a year. In this episode, we will learn about how Open Lab at Newcastle University led the Metro Futures Project, a groundbreaking public consultation involving over 20,000 people that informed the new design of the Tyne and Wear Metro rolling stock. So welcome, Simon and Hugh, to the From Newcastle podcast. It's a pleasure having you here.
Good to be here.
So I'm just going to ask you to introduce yourselves. Maybe, Simon, you can go first.
I'm a lecturer in human-computer interaction at Open Lab. And my background is largely in design. And a lot of the kind of work that I do is about what you might call research and teaching in how do we design socio-technical systems. So systems which rely on understanding how people interact with each other as well as how people interact with technology. And I've done a variety of things working with people like the Nepal Red Cross Society on planning aid distribution after environmental crises. I've done big significant projects like the one with Nexus, which is about how you engage people with public consultations and how you do so in a more creative and exploratory manner. I've done interactive artworks about exploring how we engage people in a more immersive and richer way of talking about climate action and climate change. And I've talked about working with people in community and local heritage settings as well.
And Hugh, how about yourself?
Well, I'm a customer services director at Nexus, which is the public body which owns and operates Metro. And part of my role is to champion the customer experience, make sure the customer gets the best possible, not just out of Metro, but all public transport in Northeast England. What we've learned at Nexus over the years is that if you engage the public and really involve them in how you design services, how do you design big building projects, you get a better outcome. The public really can, well, they know best in many cases, and they can tell you things that you've never thought of as the planner and the designer in the process. So when it came to building a new metro fleet, we really wanted to push that principle to the limit and have the people who are going to use the trains shape their design as much as possible.
So as listeners are aware, we're here to talk about Open Lab and the relationship with Nexus today. But Simon, maybe you could tell us a bit more about Open Lab and what it involves.
So Open Lab is a group of about 80 plus researchers. We also are now split between academics like myself, lecturers, professors and so on, and people who are doing postgraduate research. So we teach a master's in human-computer interaction, and we have PhD students as well. A lot of the work that we do tends to be about the interactions between people and technology, and the things that we're looking at is how those interactions can create a more socially just society, a fairer society, an area that we've coined called digital civics or digital citizens, so how people can be more active citizens using digital technology. And so our day-to-day stuff tends to be research projects, collaborations with organisations such as Nexus, and around those sort of topics. Much of what we do is very participatory. We like to work with people. We like to work with the organisations, with the companies, with the third sector organisations, the charities and so on, who are involved in areas like education and urban planning and social justice and so on. And working with people, working with real people, working with the users of technology, with those people whose lives are affected by that technology as well. And the other side of that research is obviously the teaching that I've mentioned before. So we have the master students and we have PhD students who also undertake research in these areas.
So you mentioned there briefly about the sort of the outreach and working with the public. The Metro Futures public consultation was one of the most far-reaching projects which is set into the wider society about a new train fleet. Maybe you could both elaborate on the project and what were the aims, what it set out to achieve. Maybe Hugh, you can go first.
Well, we knew we had a problem and we had an opportunity. The problem was we were going to commission a new train fleet that was going to be built specially for Metro. And we'd never done anything like that before. The last time a new fleet was built for Metro was in the 1970s. And this was the first new set of trains since then. So we don't know anything about how to engage around that. But we knew we wanted to involve the public as much as possible. And it was a chance conversation, actually, with a university colleague, Mark Tudor Jones at Newcastle University, that said, oh, there's these really clever people at Open Lab who you want to go and talk to about this. Because we knew we wanted to go way beyond traditional market research and answering questions on a bit of paper and on a scale of 1 to 5 and really get under the skin of how people felt about the journeys they were making now, the journeys they would make in future. We just didn't know how to do it. But in coming to Open Lab and working with Simon and the team, they really showed us a way to involve all sorts of different passengers, people with different needs, people at different stages in their lives, and kind of fit that together into something useful that we could give to train manufacturers and say, this is what local people have said they want, over to you to come back with a design that really responds to their needs and their wishes.
Absolutely. I think in Open Lab, the kind of research that we'd done up to Metro Futures was on a much smaller scale. So when we're talking about the Tyne and Wear Metro, we're looking at an infrastructure and a system which is used by people across an entire region. You will probably be able to verify that it's the busiest light rail network outside London. Lots and lots of people involved. We in Open Lab knew that the kind of interactions that we had with people, that there is value in considering things like, what's the experience like of using something? How does it feel day to day? So going beyond kind of quite simplistic measures, which might be like a multiple choice or simple interview questions, and actually trying to dive deeper into things and delve deeper. We also knew that there's ways of using digital technology to get people to envisage futures, to think about how something might look, how it might feel, what the implications of it might be. But all of those kinds of projects that we've done previously tend to be with smaller groups of people. So we might have done that with a group of 30 or so people in a series of design workshops. Now we have Nexus approaching us saying, actually, we need to make sure that we are asking people across the region, that people across the region are having a say, that we are making sure that we consider lots of different passenger types and different sorts of journey experiences in the design of the new trains. It was good to be involved in this project because we had to up our game. We had to think, how are we going to do this at scale with large numbers of people? How can we maintain that richness of doing things in small design workshops, but with many, many more people? And we had to do that at two stages, actually. And it's worth saying that Metro Futures, it's not one thing, it's a series of things. So in about 2016, 2017, that's when Nexus were looking to develop the design brief that was going to go out to the train manufacturers and also support a bid that was going to go to the Department for Transport to get the money to pay for the new fleet. And so we ran an initial part of the consultation there, which was trying these more experience-based and creative approaches. And then in 2020, once the train manufacturer Stadler had been awarded the contract and come back with a proposal, which was really nice to see that that proposal contained responses to some of the things that we'd suggest in that first consultation that responded to it, was to then take that back out to people and show it to them and say, actually, you know, is this right? Not only is this right, but there's some more decisions to be made. What have we missed? What else needs to be considered here? And so we had a second round of consultation in 2020. So it was really good to be part of that because, as I say, it made us up our game and think about how some of the things that we've done might be applicable at larger scales.
I think embedded in this was the fact that the trains are built specially for Metro, so each train will have to last 40 years. And James, if you think about this, right now you probably living in an inner city area.
I live right on the West Chesmond Metro station, so I probably use it more than the average customer.
And your journey to university is perhaps 5 or 10 minutes, yeah. And you're quite happy to stand, hold on to a pole while you're doing that. In the life of this fleet, if you stay in the northeast of England, you'll perhaps move out to the suburbs, you'll want a seat, you might have children, and then you'll want space for your pram and your pushchair. The midlife crisis will come along, and you'll need to think about whether you can get the bike on board, and then the knees will go. I hope
they already have. They already have.
But and then you'll want kind of a much more accessible space and a bit more room. Now, all of those things are going to happen in the lifetime of these trains. As Simon says, it's getting the public to think about different journey experiences, because we've got to fit all of those needs into one particular finite shaped box. And the only way we could do that was kind of through the immersive consultation, immersive public engagement that Open Lab were able to bring to this project.
So my next question, these things aren't happening in a vacuum. The last 2 years have been quite difficult. Obviously, the pandemic, it's changed how we all work. For example, we've had to postpone this podcast twice because of the pandemic. I think that's worth noting. So, I mean, were you able to deliver what you wanted to despite what was going on in the world? And I think what some of the people who've been on previously has mentioned is that they've actually found a lot of positives with how the pandemic's altered the sort of workflow and how they achieve things. So,
from our point of view as the client, if you like, who Open Lab was working for, we were very fortunate that the work that Open Lab had done digitally was so robust and reached so many people. The first stage of consultation back in 2016 or 2017, which informed the initial design, reached about 3,000 people. The second stage in 2020, right in the teeth of the pandemic, almost all of it delivered digitally, reached 23,000 people. 23,000 people engaged in that. That's probably more people than were actually using Metro during lockdown at that particular time. Now, conventional train design tells you that once you've got to a kind of final draft, the manufacturer makes a mock-up of a whole carriage, plonks it in the middle of a city centre, and has people wander in and out of it. Now, with COVID restrictions, that was impossible. But because we knew we had a richness and a depth and quality of feedback from Open Lab and a very detailed report, we could forego that stage. Now, as it happened, that saved enough money for us to be able to implement one of the biggest recommendations of Open Lab, because the public came back and said, we really like the design that our manufacturer Stadler have given us, but couldn't we get more seats into it? Of course, people always want more seats. By saving money on not having to make a wooden mock-up, we were able to afford to put 12 new seats in every carriage and deliver on one of the big findings of the consultation. And it's a remarkable and strange positive of the pandemic experience that was the case.
I was having a conversation with our producer, Steph, about the online mock-ups that you had, and they were very immersive. You felt like you're on the train. It was really easy to picture what it would be like to have a journey on one of these new rolling stocks. And I think not having to make the physical mock-ups is a happy accident. And I think, again, it leads into what other guests have been saying, that the pandemic's actually produced a lot of these happy accidents, things that are actually kind of positive, productive.
I'm glad you said you found it immersive, because that was the intention, actually. There was a moment in the planning of this process, because we'd started conversations in 2019 or late 2018, and we were at the stage of agreeing what we were going to do. And then lockdown happened and we had to rethink, and we came up with the proposals for what we did. And we did things like we made much more use of social media to get people's interest, to get an initial engagement and then drive them to the website where they could experience that immersion more. It's worth saying that doing things digitally allowed us to do things that you would not be able to do with a physical mock-up. For example, in the traditional inverted commas method of kind of train design, where you go to Newcastle Central Station and there is a full-size mock-up, that's a rather artificial environment. You're only visiting at a particular kind of day, it's not a real train, and it's static. So what we were able to do with the website, and it was in three parts, there was one part you might remember where we allowed people to try out different materials for seating, try out different colours. You can't do that with a static mock-up. You can't do that creative exploration of thinking, what would it look like? Another part of the website, we use 360-degree images. If you visit the physical mock-up, you're only there at a particular time of day. And whoever's in the mock-up is in the mock-up. So in the 360 version, we made it so you could fill the train with kind of neutral-looking characters or not. You'd look at it during the day or at night. So if you're thinking about the colour of materials, about patterns, about contrast and accessibility, how does it look at night is very important. And the last thing we did in the website, we had a journeys section. I think the problem we'd recognise with a lot of consultations is it's very easy to talk about your own experiences and your own preferences, but we wanted people to think about those people who have very particular needs, who have very unique needs in terms of their journeys. A young mother travelling with a pushchair and a child that's of toddler age. Somebody with a visual impairment. Somebody who uses a wheelchair. If we'd taken a more traditional approach, where we just tried to get consensus of opinion on various things, those people might have been in a minority and their voice wouldn't have been very strong. So to do that at scale, we had these kind of imagined scenarios based on real world people's experiences of what it's like to use the train if you are travelling with a pushchair and you've got young children. And we got really useful feedback from a large number of people putting themselves in somebody else's shoes. And we couldn't have done that as easily with a physical mock-up.
The reason why I think it reached so many people was that you could spend a minute or two on giving an opinion on a particular question that was posed on Twitter or something like that. But then if you wanted to explore further, you were led into it.
As research, because this has to be research for us as a research group, we've got really useful material about kind of how long do people spend on the website? How much engagement did it create? And this is something that's different as well. So we talk about a digital consultation, but a lot of digital consultations are quite lightweight because it's about getting as many people through the system. But we saw people exploring different sections of the website, spending time on things, going through those design options more than once and selecting what they found most agreeable and so forth.
It's totally different, isn't it, to how many times have you received a survey and it says, don't worry, this will only take you 10 minutes or 15 minutes to complete the survey. So the researcher is defining how long you're allowed to spend thinking about it. And this way round, you're actually led into the process. You can spend as long as you want. You can go back over things. You can think about the question you answered 5 minutes ago and then go back to it. And so actually, the user was in control of the experience. And the website was just about facilitating that sense of control.
I'd like to just add to that, actually, because as well as being in control of the experience, the people in the digital consultation actually influence the consultation itself. There are certain things that you need to be able to kind of try out. You know, can you actually get a large powered wheelchair on and off a train? Is there enough space to maneuver it? The conversations we were having with people in workshops and on the website actually said, well, we do like this central grab pole to be a double pole. More people can put their hands on it. Now, Stadler were always going to produce a physical mock-up that would enable Nexus to understand and evaluate some of those ergonomic aspects. And that was changed. Halfway through, they changed it to be a double pole.
In the design online, we'd set perch seats in the wheelchair area. And some of the very early feedback from wheelchair users was that the wheelchair area should be for wheelchair users, and it would reduce conflict if the perch seats were not there, because you don't want to have to ask someone to move in order to occupy the space. So the wheelchair users said, well, could we have a horizontal grab rail instead, which also gives you a bit of security when you're sat in that space. And as Simon says, the small mock-up that we were using with disability groups meant Stadler could put that in and we could test it instantly. The same as with the double pole. It came through very strongly and very early on in the digital consultation that passengers preferred a double pole and more things to hold on to. We were worried that a guide dog user may find themselves dragged into the pole and brushed against it by the dog because the pole's wider further up than it was low down. So Stadler raced across a model for this pole and we fitted it into the small mock-up and we got some guide dog users to use that and tested it out. So the digital engagement was feeding the work we were doing with the ergonomics for disabled people in real time while it was going on. It was a fascinating process.
So I think a key theme that I've noticed here is accessibility. Why is this an important part of this project?
We have a big guiding principle, which is if you design a train that's good for people who have disabilities, people who are in wheelchairs or visual impairments or other disabilities, then you design a better train for everyone. But it's particularly important on Metro because since it was opened in the 1980s, it's always set the standard for wheelchair access to the system. And today we have around 50,000 wheelchair journeys on Metro every year. The vast majority of them are not supported by staff, so you don't need to call ahead to check that someone's going to be on the station to help you board. That will get so much better when it comes to boarding the trains because Stadler have designed in a sliding step to close the gap between the train and the platform. But getting on the train is only half the experience. And it was really important that for those people to know with confidence that they could get on board a train, the same spontaneity as everybody else takes for granted, that we got the wheelchair design right. And it was an area which Open Lab worked on very particularly. We engaged with them very closely because it was one of the huge outcomes we wanted to achieve from this project.
Yeah, that was really important. It was about the experience. And we're quite fortunate that we were able to draw on existing relationships. We work with the Campaign for Level Boarding about this. You know, getting on and off public transport is a significant challenge for a number of people who use wheelchairs and other forms of mobility aid. It was really good to involve those people in this work. To go back to the point of, you know, if you're in the wheelchair space, our wheelchair users said, if you're an able-bodied person on a train, you might get asked once per day on a rare occasion to move out of a wheelchair space. That wheelchair users might have had to ask people 20 times. And that's a consideration. And they also said, well, you've got this thing on the train, when you put your brake on, we don't put our brakes on. Actually, you know, I'm going to put my brake on and then when the train breaks, I'll fall out of my chair. That's no good. What I need is something to hold on to. If you don't have the perch seats there, I don't have to ask someone to move. And so all of these things came from those conversations, that focus on experience, that exploration. So I think absolutely we have much better trains as a result, or we will.
If this relationship between Open Lab and Nexus hadn't have taken place, would we have seen a lot of the changes and design choices implemented?
We're both biased, but I think we wouldn't have had as well-grounded and kind of people-focused and passenger-focused design decisions made as have been without this consultation. I think that's absolutely the case.
When we approached Open Lab, we said, we want the public to shape the design and we want you to challenge us. And I can tell you that Open Lab were very challenging and they were very forceful in coming back and saying, passengers have said this, different user groups have said that. What are you really doing about this? And are you taking it on? And yes, there's a number of areas that I would point to that are about the little details of design that Simon's mentioned around the wheelchair area. A lot of work around cycle storage and how you secure a bike wheel and different designs for that, which were tested. Color definition between walls and floors, which somebody without a visual impairment wouldn't even notice, would perhaps take for granted, but which were all strengthened as a result
of the
design.
With the visual impairment, the one thing that I remember from the online designer and going through the website is the button enlargement on the doors. That was something that I would have never thought about, just like making that button slightly larger so that people with visual impairments can actually see it and more effectively. And again, I think that leads into it's the small changes that have been made possible by the consultation.
I'd also like to mention that we work with the deaf community. We had a workshop that was conducted in British Sign Language. We work with Becoming Visible, a really important organisation. And that a lot of the design decisions, or a lot of the consideration of the trains is about the train as a kind of platform for delivering information as well. So the visual display screens, the way the audio announcement works as well. This isn't just a metal box. It's not just a vehicle with various physical design features in it. It's actually a platform, if you'll excuse the pun, for delivering a service to passengers. And that was very much what we were talking about with people as well.
So you work for Nexus U. Are you aware that any other public transport providers nationwide have been sort of working with the public in this way, working with people like Open Lab?
I would actually talk about worldwide in that context. We're an urban transport system, so we naturally talk to systems in global cities across the world when it comes to these things. And this is new ground in terms of train design. The way this has been done, the immersive consultation, the break with the tradition of questionnaire followed by physical mock-up. This is new and has been recognised as such and has won awards for innovation from the global light rail industry. And I think Open Lab fully deserved to have done that. I have come across traditional consultations where it's gone wrong. I won't name the city, although it's in Asia, where they did a traditional pen and ink kind of question and answer consultation. And lots of people wrote down that they wanted more luggage space for when they went to the airport. The manufacturer put in large luggage racks, and the only people that ever actually used them were small children who clambered over them and kind of crawled into the gaps, as a result of which, within 2 years, they quite expensively took them out again. And it's a standout example of how sometimes consultation with the best intentions goes wrong, because it's not really challenging people to think about the whole use case and the whole journey experience, and that's what Open Lab achieved. And that's why the rest of the world is starting to look at this and say, there's something really clever happened here in Newcastle, and it's something that can be replicated in other cities in the future.
So Simon, do you think this is why it's important for Newcastle University to sort of use its knowledge and research to work with external organisations?
Absolutely, yeah. This is why Open Labs' raison d'etre is collaboration. We like to work with other organisations because everyone brings their own expertise. Nexus are a publicly funded organisation. They have certain obligations as a transport authority as well in terms of the things like the guidelines and the guidance they have to follow. We can come in and be quite provocative and challenging, but we also have to learn that these things have to last for 40 years, that trains need to last for 40 years, that are certain regulatory requirements as well. We learn as part of these processes as well. And the third group, obviously, is the public. You know, so we might bring expertise in using technology and methodology, but in terms of the domain of public transport, there's professional experience and there's passenger and public experience. And there's something that really, really valuable, important that comes together from those three things overlap.
So who do you think you'll work with Open Lab again? This will be something that you'll mobilise in the future?
This has been a very unique project and about something which will become an icon for the region. Our current train fleet on Metro is known by everybody in the Northeast far and wide. The new trains will be around for 40 years to come. But actually, I do think it opens the door probably to something more profound. There are huge questions facing society around the climate emergency and air quality that involve us all rethinking fundamental aspects of our life. I mean, yes, we're a public transport organisation, so the big issue we're struggling with is how do we convince more people to feel comfortable giving up private motor vehicles or even electric vehicles in future and using mass transit? What do you need to do to change that mindset in big numbers? And it strikes me that the kind of research that Open Lab is doing that really delves into behaviours could potentially offer the key to answer some of those questions and really open up that debate. And that's something that we're already talking with Open Lab about the future.
So the new trains are expected in 2023. How are you both feeling about what this will mean to the people around Newcastle upon Tyne and the wider North East region?
I'm excited about it. I'm excited to go on one of the first trains, actually. It will be thrilling, actually, to look around, to be a passenger, to be a customer, but also to recognise features in the trains and know where they came from. I think it's important to say there is no such thing as a perfect train. And what we have is a train which tries its best to satisfy all those different kinds of passenger experiences for the next 40 years and be a platform for those experiences and be adaptable to those experiences. So I'm really, really looking forward to what people will make of it.
I'm incredibly excited about the new trains coming, partly because they will be 15 times more reliable. They will use at least 30% less energy compared to the current fleet, but also because of the transformation in journey experience. And that's what we've been talking about. One of the fundamental things about the Tyne and Wear Metro is that local people feel a huge amount of ownership of it. It is their railway and it is unique to the Northeast. And they've also over the years felt a huge amount of pride. I would like to think that many of those 23,000 people who took part in the Open Lab engagement will get on that train and recognise features that they saw in the design, recognise the difference that they made, perhaps the way that they influenced the design, and most of all, feel a huge amount of pride, not just about their involvement, but about what has been created for the region and for all of us.
Something I want to ask is obviously these trains are icons of the Northeast. There's a sense of nostalgia when you get on the Metro that it's something of a prior age. Are you going to miss the old rolling stock?
The current trains have been with us for 40 years, and people from outside the region are sometimes surprised that they've been around that long because they are just about the oldest trains in the country now. But of course, that means that many people grew up with them, and there are some features that we're all familiar with. In particular, I'd mention the front seat beside the driver, which will be lost when the new trains come in. So there'll be a little bit of sadness, but it's also about that step into the future, which we have to make. One of the things that we have included in the fleet, instead of the front seat where you can pretend to be driver, and James, I can tell you still pretend to be driver.
And I can.
Yeah, I know I do. But we can't have that because the train driver themselves, they need an ergonomic and modern cab. And the new one is the full width. Drivers will have a CCTV view throughout the train. They have a lot more information about how the train's working as they're driving along. The communication with the carriage and with customers in the carriage is much stronger. So all sorts of benefits there. So yes, we say goodbye to the passenger seat at the front of the train, but we say hello to something new, which did emerge through the consultation, which is that we're going to be the first train operator in the world to commission major new pieces of public art into the space. So at the end of each space, there'll be some really kind of characterful and new works of art created by four amazing artists we've commissioned with funding from the Arts Council England. And that's something new, which will become, in its own way, that little piece of unique Northeast heritage in time that you can't find anywhere else in the world. And I think that is true to the spirit of Metro.
That was one of the things that we pushed Nexus on, thinking about this really, because it wasn't on the table as something that was going to be discussed as part of the consultation. And we'd say, well, we know people feel a sense of pride in the Metro. There is this space behind the drivers. What harm could it do asking people what they want there? And I think the other thing to say is that the trains aren't exactly going away. They won't be running on the network, but there will be some trains preserved.
Yes, that's right. They won't be gone completely. At least I hope not. We've provided up to two trains for heritage organisations such as museums, and we have had interest from museums in the northeast of England to take at least two of the cars intact. We've also been running, I'll call it a challenge rather than a competition, for community groups to suggest alternative uses for the trains in future as community facilities. We've had a whole range of suggestions from schools through to the fire service.
In London, some of the old tube rolling stock are now like classrooms or like libraries. So it would be something similar.
Yeah, we hope so. I mean, it's not the easiest thing in the world to take on a train, you know, one careful owner after 40 years. But we certainly hope that the trains will have some use in future for the community, but also you'll be able to find them in museums. And actually, the story of their whole life through to the creation of the new trains will be told for future generations.
And my final question is for you, Hugh. So we like to ask this to all of our partners. What do you like about working with Newcastle University, and specifically Open Lab?
I will be absolutely honest and say challenge. We didn't go to a commercial organisation that just wanted to please us, just wanted to collect its fee and then move on. Throughout this process, throughout the planning of it, and then as the results were starting to come in, Open Lab were forceful on behalf of the people that they were bringing together in the engagement, the people that they were hearing from, and they were feeding that back to us. And we are a public body, and by really hearing people, you get better outcomes. And Open Lab took us on that journey and probably pushed us a bit further than we were initially comfortable, but that's just a good thing. And you asked how we felt about the new trains coming. There's very few projects I'll look back on in my working life with as much pride as this. And that's because we went so far on this journey and we did so much that was new, all of which was about the customer experience, all of which was about hearing the voice of the user. And Open Lab made that possible.
And Simon, maybe what do you like about working with Nexus?
It's a dream project. As researchers in human-computer interaction, we are always trying to work with interesting organisations, novel contexts, trying to get under the skin of really interesting, thorny issues. To get to work with an organisation like Nexus and look at something as big and significant as the Tyne and Wear Metro, that's a dream come true.
So I'd like to say thank you to both of you, Hugh, Simon. Thank you for coming on the From Newcastle podcast.
Pleasure to be here.
To find out more about Open Lab and the Metro Futures Project, visit podcasts.ncl.ac.uk/from Newcastle. Next time, we will be joined by Dr. Nicola Heselhurst and Amy McNaughton to talk about health inequalities in pregnancy.
Thank you for listening to this episode of From Newcastle. If you enjoyed it, then please click the subscribe button. We would love to hear your comments or suggestions, so please get in touch at fromnewcastlepodcast@ncl.ac.uk or via our social media at fromnclpodcast.